Let's go ahead and get started. My name is Amanda Chun, and I am the Research Manager and Curator here at MS Rao. Thank you all so much for joining us for this latest iteration of our Bourbon with Bill webinar series. It's so wonderful to have everyone back again. This evening, as always, we're going to be chatting with third generation owner and CEO of MS Rao, Mr. Bill Rao. The topic today is the aristocratic home, and Bill will be taking us on a tour of sorts through the great British estates, a la the Bridgertons and Downton Abbey. He's going to be discussing pieces of fine art and antiques that would have once been right at home in one of these stately houses. If you're joining us this evening because you have a specific interest in English silver, I do want to take this opportunity to plug our latest virtual exhibition. It's titled All That Glitters. It's going to be launching this coming weekend on Saturday. In this online exclusive show, we are exploring the work of four major silversmiths, three of them being British smiths: Paul Delamory, Hester Bateman, and Paul Storr. You'll be seeing some works of silver by those smiths tonight as well. But if you have a specific interest in silver, I encourage you to visit msrao.com this weekend to check out that exhibition. This evening, we are going to be talking about a little bit more than just silver. We'll be touching on a myriad of categories from porcelain and furniture to fine art and timepieces. If at any point throughout our conversation you have a question about a piece or about the gallery in general, feel free to just ask. Simply press that Q&A button at the bottom of your screen to send in your question. We're going to try to answer as many of those as we can before the webinar. Now, I know you're not here to see me. Without further ado, I would like to welcome Mr. Bill Rao. Hi, Bill. How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I'm doing great, thanks. Let's dive right in, shall we?
Of
We
course.
are going to start our discussion tonight in that all-important room, the dining room. Now, historically, this was the space where the entire family could gather. It was also an important space to entertain, and the English of the 18th and 19th centuries would spend lavishly on the space. Therefore, it seems most appropriate that we would start our talk tonight with a truly lavish set of silver. Bill, what can you tell us about these candelabra candlesticks from Paul Storr?
Well, thanks. First of all, I think it's important to understand the dining room really was the center of the home. It was the one room where both men and women were expected to be together. Often, and we're going to go through this, some those other rooms where there were more female rooms and more male-dominated rooms. And this was the room where people would spend many hours together. Meals could last 3 and 4 hours, and often there was company, and it was where one entertained always. And so it was one of the best places. If you were to show off your very best things, this was where you would show them off. And this, if somebody had this, this is one of their very best things. This is a pair of candelabras and a pair of matching candlesticks all together. It would have been a suite made by the great Paul Storr. Paul Storr was the most famous Regency silversmith, arguably one of the greatest silversmiths, if not the greatest silversmith of all time, although we're going to get to another silversmith later on that would make that same argument, not in the Regency part, but certainly in the greatest of all time. And it's hard to understand from this picture how amazing these are. These are quite large. You can sort of see the wine bottle with them and see the scale. I mean, usually a normal candlestick, your house will be smaller than a wine bottle. This one sort of dwarfs a wine bottle, much less the candelabra. But it's the qualities, so it's really important. These were made in 1808. We can go to the next picture. And you can sort of see the detail of it. These were made in 1808, and at this time, England had become by far the wealthiest country in the world. And they were trying, and so somebody who had something like this would have gone to the best silversmith there was in the world of his day, Paul Storr, and ordered the single greatest set of candelabra. There's only one other one like this known. Actually, we can go to the next picture. And that was one that was owned by the Duke of Bedford. Theirs had a top that was not quite as nice as ours, but the exact same base. In fact, that top to me sort of is quite light, and you can go back to ours again. And you can sort of see the heftiness of our tops and the three lights versus two lights and so forth. That was the only other set model known like this. And so these would have been made for somebody of great wealth. They would have been extraordinarily expensive, and they would have went across the whole table. But one of the nice things about them, one of the reasons that extra height is so important, is because they could have stayed at a table and you could have seen through them. They wouldn't have blocked one's view when you were sitting across the table from one person. And because they were thin and because they were also thin across the three lights and not, if you think of a three light, you can have it on one plane, but if you get into a four light or a five light, it starts to become wide. Well, that's important that there are three light because the two people at the end of the table, often the host would be able to see all the way down the table. It wouldn't block their view. So these were something that made by the best maker really at, you know, at the height of the Regency period in the single best model of a candelabra ever found. And they're complete and perfect and better than the only set made for the Duke of Bedford. So it really doesn't get any better than that to start off on your dining room table.
That's so true. All right. So while the tablescape was usually dominated by silver like this, it was not unusual to see a few other impressive pieces thrown into the mix. This jardinière by Minton would work equally well as a centerpiece or on a sideboard. It also has a fascinating history. Bill, can you please share its story?
So this is of all the pieces we're going to show is the one that the photographs just can't do it justice. You see the wine bottle next to it, but even then you don't realize how large this is. This was a jardinière, but so if one would think during the 19th century where the very best pieces were made, they were made for two places. They were made for royalty and they were made for the great exhibitions. If you made something for royalty, if those silver candelabras we showed a second ago were made for royalty, Paul Storer would have put them in their window a month and a half before they delivered them and just let them show. So that was a way of saying, oh, look, we made things for royalty. However, probably the single best way in the second half of the 19th century was to make things for the World's Fair. And this is a Minton Majolica jardinière. We'll go to the next picture. And it's hard to see, but from this angle, but you can sort of see the inside of it. It opens up. If you were putting bottles of wine in there, I would guess that you could hold 6 or 8 bottles of wine in the inside of this with ice. And I'm not far off, and maybe, you know, maybe even 10. I don't know. We haven't tried it yet. Minton starts in the early 19th century, and they're a good company, and they're achieving minor fame. And then 1851 was the first World's Fair. It was the Crystal Palace Exhibition, which took place in London. Queen of England comes to the Crystal Palace Exhibition and buys a number of things in Minton and says, this firm has things in the very best taste. And then Minton took off. And so they loved doing things to the great international exhibitions. But in the beginning, this is Majolica. Nobody knew how to make something this large because this was made in the kiln by itself. It wasn't made in pieces that were put together. It was made all at one time, and that was extraordinarily difficult. So they kept trying to get bigger and bigger. Why bigger and bigger? Because these world's fairs were giant places and you needed large things to get people's attentions. A little small teapot wasn't going to do it at the World's Fair. I think we go to the next picture. And if you see the arrow, here it is. Here is either this one or probably this one. They made three at the World's Fair in 1876, the Centennial World Exhibition in Philadelphia. Now, I mentioned World's Fairs were the best places to get your name out there. I want to give you an idea how big of a deal this was. The Centennial World's Fair in 1876, they had over 10 million visitors. The population of the United States in 1876 was at 40 million people. So more than 1 in 4 people visited, and more than 1 in 4 people, over 25% of the population of the United States visited the World's Fair in 1876. And so Minton obviously has this big giant exhibition filled with some amazing things. But what is the piece that they chose that when the fair picked out the very best things in the fair, what is the piece that they chose to write about? We can go to the next picture. And here it is our centerpiece, which is the piece they chose to write about how extraordinary Minton was and the top things to see at the fair. But its fame doesn't end here. One of the three that were made, and we go to the next picture, I think, was used in the mirror in the movie Annie. And there it is in the movie Annie with two fannies, I suppose. So of the housekeepers, it's something. But this actually gives this idea of its scale, where you realize how great of a piece this would be to put on the center of a table. And the reality is, it could have gone on a sideboard and it could have gone on the center of a table. But it was a way, if somebody had this, of showing off of, I have the best of the of everything in the world. We can go to the next picture, I think. And, you know, there it is once again with its beautiful colors and beautiful detail. It has the mermaids, and it's a piece that if you see the picture, you go, it's lovely. And when you see it in person, you go, wow, because it just blows you away in person.
Thanks, Bill. So we actually have our first question of the night. Someone is asking what it is made out of. So can you explain to us what majolica is?
Certainly. So there's hard-paste porcelain and soft-paste porcelain, and they're made slightly different. Soft paste is similar to pottery, and hard paste is, the difference between hard paste, which is some people call true porcelain, is that it's translucent. If you put it up to a light, you can see the light behind it. Majolica is soft paste porcelain. And it's revival of a pottery that came from the first was made in the Italian island of Majorca. And don't hold me to this, I think in the 17th century they started making it. And it was this wonderful colorful pottery. But so in England, in the 19th century, they loved this, but they wanted to make it with the 19th century flair, with a modern flair. And Minton was the single best maker. And the single best pieces made by Minton were the ones for the World's Fair. And this is the most important one made for the World's Fair. So to me, it's the greatest of the greatest.
Great, thanks, Bill. And great question, thank you so much. And if anyone else has any questions along the way, please feel free and use that Q&A button. All right, so let's move along. In addition to these decorative objects, it's true that the English also had a specific serving tool for just about every part of the meal. This Argyle pot by Hester Bateman certainly drives that point home. Bill, what in the world would this pot have been used for?
Well, let me start off by saying we helped assemble an extraordinary collection of silver over about a 20-year span, a client of ours who sadly passed away a couple years ago, and we've taken in his silver to sell from his daughter. And there were 400 and something pieces in the collection, and I would say arguably, certainly in my top five pieces, this would have been one of them. And it was by far the simplest and maybe one fraction of the price of the other four that I would have chosen. But it's something that's really special. It's an Argyle pot. It's one of just a few known. What's an Argyle pot? We can go to the next picture. An Argyle pot is, first of all, if you looked in the inside of this, there's a well. The outside skin and the inside skin don't meet. There's a space between it. Now, if you look where the arrow is in the picture, you'll see the little part that lifts up. You put boiling water in there so the pot itself would stay hot, and you put gravy in the inside. And that's so the gravy wouldn't congeal during the meal. It would stay warm and stay in its liquid form. And so this would be to pour gravy, because anybody who's ever, you know, been to a great English meal, there's gravy, and it does actually add a lot of flavor. But this is made by Hester Bateman. Hester Bateman was the most famous female silversmith ever. She was arguably the most famous female craftsman of the 18th century. She was this wonderful businesswoman who made beautiful things, but in a feminine touch. But I love this because it's one of just maybe three or four known, these Argyle pots, and they're exceptionally rare. And it's a beautiful piece that would just set you put on the table and use it, it's fun.
Well, we do love rare pieces like this. Another thing that we love here at MS Rao are those things that have a great story. This next item is just that. We really don't need to speculate about where this next set would have appeared in the great British estate, because we know exactly who owned it, none other than the Duke of Hamilton. Bill, can you please share its story?
Well, certainly. First of all, the Duke of Hamilton was very famous, and then it became more famous. Lady Hamilton had her torrid affair with Lord Nelson, who was the most famous non-royal of the day, and certainly the most famous British military hero of all time. Trafalgar Square for they'll that have been to England is an honorary of Lord Nelson with him standing upon the column in the center. The Duke of Hamilton was extraordinarily wealthy. And so let's take a step backwards about this set. The reason why we call porcelain China is because all China originally came from the Far East, and specifically China originally. And so the Duke, and it wasn't what this was, this set was made about 1780 1790. Porcelain wasn't even discovered into the 17 teens and how to make it in Europe. All the ingredients that make porcelain are found together in certain parts of Asia. They're not found together anywhere in the West. And so they had to experiment with how to put it together. So the first set of this Duke of Hamilton buys, he buys a set that was made in China with his coat of arms. We can go to the next picture. Look at this wonderful coat of arms in these pieces. One piece is more beautiful than the next. And then he realizes that they can actually do an equally good set in America, in England. And he goes to the firm, he goes to either Derby or the other firm, and Derby or the other firm, and says, I'd like a set. It's too much of an order for both one firm to do it, so they share it with the other. And they make this extraordinary set with this coat of arms on it. Every single piece is just amazing. We can go to the next picture, I think. Here's the rest of the set is in the Metropolitan Museum of Art. So here's the set, and here's one of the dishes that's in the Met. But we have the whole set. We have the rest of the set. The complete set. It was a giant service at one time. We can go to the next picture, I think. And you can see how many pieces in this plate set are stacked up there. So it was a complete service that filled with serving pieces. There's many services out there, not made for the Duke of Hamilton, that you'll see, you know, 40 plates and three serving pieces. Look at the serving pieces in this, you know, which was where the most money was. And it's just an amazing thing made for somebody that if enough people died, he would have become king. And in an extraordinary set. And there's basically two sections of it known, one set in the Met and our set. So it's really exciting. And it would have, when you laid this on the table, people knew who you were.
It's certainly a great way to round out our tour of the dining room. And now that we've enjoyed this meal of sorts, let's head on over to the library to conduct a bit of business. First, we're going to look at a stunning piece of furniture by Wright and Mansfield. Bill, will you tell us a little bit about this cabinet?
I mentioned the Majolica piece may be hard to understand, and the Paul Stora, how good they are from pictures. This is another one. Wright Mansfield was an extraordinary maker of furniture, and this was made about 1860. It was made for an exhibition. Sadly, we cannot find out which one. It's one of those things that somebody was trying to show off. They were trying to do, and there was not a place in this cabinet where it's not superior. We can go to the next picture if you don't mind. I want you to see the detail of it. So first of all, if you look at it, that's an ivory plaque and it's all engraved. That by itself is a work of art, and there's about 8 or 10 different plaques on the piece. That's satinwood in the background. Look at the figuring of the satinwood. Satinwood by itself was almost typically used in little thin lines as an inlay, never as a whole piece of furniture, much less as a giant cabinet or sideboard. It's all inlaid with ivory, and then it's inlaid with other woods in there. So you have beautiful workmanship on figured satinwood, which is so rare, with little inlay in there, which is, it's beautiful. We go to the next picture, I think. Even the columns are made of ebony and ivory, and every little bit about this, you can actually see the figuring, like with the marble by itself is now extinct. It's a rare Italian marble. Even underneath the marble, you'll see, like, you can see the figuring of the wood and the movement of it. And then even below that, some ormolu. And we go back to the full picture. When you open up the cabinets, the inside is figured satinwood. It's not a cheaper wood, or what's known as a secondary wood, where you could put cheaper things because people wouldn't see it. This was a way of showing off. Somebody would have put this in their library, and they would have been able to put their, you know, smoke, maybe they're smoking utensils inside of it and their books in the center, and then open it up and be able to show off. And it was something that somebody had, they were saying, I have the absolute best in the world.
So this next work is a painting that also would have been right at home in a library considering its subject. This is the legendary tutor to the gods, Chiron, with his student Achilles. Bill, will you please tell us the story behind this work?
Well, certainly. So if we were having a Zoom meeting in 1860, a webinar, I should say, when 1860, when this was painting was made, I would not have to say the next part. And the reason is everybody that was educated in 1860 understood the classics, and the one thing that they all understood more than anything else was the Iliad and the Odyssey, and they would, this is a scene that they would have instinctively known, just as we would know George Washington crossing the Delaware as an American, or you know any of the great scenes. This was something they would have known. So Chiron is the centaur, and he was the teacher of Hercules and Achilles and other great gods and demigods. And here it is, here's young Achilles, the greatest warrior, the greatest athlete of his day, being taught how to hunt. And I just love it because, I mean, first of all, look at the muscles on Achilles. And I love the centaur. He's sitting there, he's all focused on this. And so when we talked about objects being, you know, getting well known, and you'd want to make them for royalty, and you'd want to make them for the great exhibitions. For paintings, it was slightly different. For paintings, the single greatest honor an artist could ever achieve was to be exhibited at the Salon, the Paris Salon. It happened every 2 years, and if you got invited to go there, you would make your greatest painting, and you would make it of scale because you'd want to show up on the wall, and you wanted to have something that people would instinctively know. So this painting was actually in the Salon in 1861, which is really great. So it's we can go to the next picture, I think. Don't we have a scale shot? Go back to the first one. I apologize, that one's good. We'll get to the next one in a second. I apologize. And so this is something that it would have just stood out on the walls, but I love it because if in a library, this would have shown that you had education. You would have put this in your library, you understood the classics, you knew this, and it was a little bit of a warrior, and it was the whole package in this painting. This painting also has a second surprise. It has a painting on the back, which is not unheard of, but still very quite rare. We assume that the artist had started the painting in a vertical format, a portrait format it's called, and then turned it and then didn't like it and said, I'm going to change it, or it wasn't working. It's possible, but not likely, that he bought the canvas from somebody and just turned it and said, I like it, I'm going to restretch it. But it's wonderful. So you sort of get two paintings in one. But I do think if you bought it, you would probably end up with the education of Achilles, and not the back of the painting on your walls. And it's just a large, beautiful, perfect work of art made for the Paris Salon that would have been perfectly at home in a library.
And no library was complete without an up-to-date globe. This pair that we're going to talk about by Carey represents the very best that money can buy. Bill, what makes these globes better than the rest?
First of all, I think it's important to understand a little bit about globes. If you look at like pictures of King George III and George Washington and Louis XV, they're standing often with their hand on a globe. It showed that they were men of the world. It showed that they were people of the world, that they were knowledgeable. And so people wanted globes. The single best maker of globes was John and William Carey of London, and globes came in different sizes. There were small globes, table globes, and then floor globes would come in 12, 15, 18, and 21 inches. Now, instinctively, if I ask most people how much bigger a 21-inch globe is than a 12-inch globe, you may say it's 75% bigger, but it's not. It's actually 307% bigger. And the reason is it doesn't just get bigger one way, it gets bigger the whole way. So it gets, you know, obviously the whole circumference gets bigger. And if you had a lot of money, you didn't have just the earth, but you had the earth in the sky. And that's why you had two globes. We can go to the next picture. So this is a picture of the cartouche that says Cary, and it says 1836, but underneath it, it says, 1816, but underneath it, it says with later additions, with additions up to 1836. So what does that mean? Somebody bought this globe in 18, was it, I can't remember if it was 1816 or 1818, or we'll get to the slide in, at the end, and I'll remember then, so I apologize. It was 1816, so we can go back. So somebody bought these in 1816, and then in 1836, there had been so many more discoveries that had been made. They sent the terrestrial globe, not the celestial globe, the terrestrial globe, back to Cary's. It would have taken them a little bit of time and cost a lot of money, and be able to, and they would update it. Now, if you see like next to the cartouche right there, there's lines that go up and they sort of go up to a point. You can't see the point in the picture, but you can see eventually they'll hit a point at the North Pole. Those are spheres, and those were pieces of paper. So when they would send them back, there would be discoveries maybe in Africa, maybe in South America. They would only change three or four or five spheres to be able to show the updated on it. So this was something that was really great, because you could know somebody had this for over 20 years when they sent it back, and they kept it longer because this was something that would have been so valuable to have in a house, and it showed that you were worldly. We can go to the next picture. I love this picture because you see Africa, and when you see it up close, which is hard to do on a Zoom call, where it's really the widest part, where in Africa, it says unknown parts. Nobody's ever been there. This is pre-Stanley. This is pre-Livingston. This is pre-Speaks. They don't know what the center of Africa looks like. It's unknown. That's just great. So even in 1836, they had not a clue. They knew what the coast looked like because it had been sailed around for centuries at that point in time and traded with. But the inside, they knew nothing about what the inside of Africa looked like, which just thrills me to see, today where, we know everything and it's just great. We can go to the next picture. This is the celestial globe. It shows the stars, but what you see right here are the constellations. Those are the great constellations that people look at. Now, once again, people in 1816, when this was made, and this would not have been updated, in 1816, when this was made, how can I say this? People knew the stars. Why? It was dark outside. For us, certainly for us that live in cities, it's very hard to see all the stars. But in 1816, before there was certainly gas lighting out in the major cities in London, but you walked a little bit away from that, it was pitch black and you could see all the stars. And keep in mind, in the winter in England, it got dark really early. It got dark at 4 p.m. and you could start seeing this. And so people would stay outside and look at the stars, and they knew many of the constellations. So to have the earth in the sky in your house is something that's really quite special. Oh, I apologize. Here's the compass on the bottom. Once again, the north and south, but it's just showing that your way around the world. They're an extraordinary thing. They're in Cuban mahogany, and they're just extraordinary. I wish I had a 12-inch globe that I could have photographed with these to show the difference in scale and size to them.
So these globes will tell us the where. Now we need a clock to tell us the when. Any nobleman conducting business in his library would certainly wish to have the time readily at hand. This long case clock would be both a practical and a beautiful addition to the room. Bill, what can you tell us about this timepiece?
Well, this is a classic 18th century clock. It's 1780. It's a tall case, or in America known as a grandfather clock. It goes all the way to the floor, which we'll see in a minute. But it had something that was special, and this is something that unlike Achilles and the education of Achilles that most people on this call probably are not familiar with or vaguely familiar with, where almost everybody on my Zoom call in 1861 was familiar with. This is something that everybody will be familiar with. We can go to the close-up. So this is the clock face, but the top of that's Adam and Eve, getting their apple. Now I'm going to show you a picture. This is what's known as an automaton. Now, sadly, movement on Zoom calls don't work all that great. So I apologize. Let's go to the next picture. And you'll see it, hopefully. You can see it, Eve reaching, hey, take an apple. And but look at the snake climbing the tree. It's just something that's so cool. And it goes around and around and around. And it's an automaton, so you could look at it. And once again, everybody would have known that story then, and everybody still knows it today. You know, you can sort of say, I love the snake that goes around the tree. You know, here's a close-up of the wonderful fretwork at the top of the clock and the weights and the pendulum. But you see those lights behind the weights and the pendulum, those lights, that's holes in the back of the clock. And that you expect to see that, you want to see that. Why is that? People would bolt their clock to the walls because a clock that was bolted to the walls, first of all, couldn't fall over, couldn't be knocked over if somebody ran into it. But also, if it was sturdy, it kept more efficient time. Because obviously, if there's a rock in the clock or a rock in the floor, if somebody's jumping around, it could send the pendulum off a little bit. But if it's sturdy to the wall and that doesn't move, it would keep a more accurate time. And there's a picture of it all. Look at the wonderful movement on the bottom of the case. It's just something that's lovely. And I love the fact that it's Adam and Eve and it's an automaton. So, you know, people walk up and that automaton's working all the time. Some automatons in some clocks, certainly in some 19th century clocks, only work when they're turned on. You know, but so the clock part will work, but the automaton only work when it turns on. This would work all the time. So it's really, to me, quite desirable.
We have a great question here from the audience. Someone's asking about the significance of the animals in the automaton, particularly the unicorn. Can you speak to that?
It's just that it was, I can't tell you exactly what the artist had in mind, but you know, they were trying to show the Garden of Eden and because all the God's creations were there. And what's a better God's creation than a unicorn, which doesn't exist anymore? We won't get into the fact whether it ever exists or not. I haven't been around that long, so I don't know. What a better way to, because almost any other animal you'd put there that we would recognize would still exist, but the unicorn's the one animal that we would look at and say all of God's creatures were there.
And another audience member is saying that the unicorn could have been a symbol of Jesus Christ as well.
That's whoever would have had this would have certainly been well versed in the Bible. So, if that was a given on a clock like this.
Thank you. All right, so we have finished our business in the library. It's time to head over to the drawing room for a spot of tea. The drawing room, this was historically a female realm. This is where women entertained following a meal while the men remained in the dining room or headed to their study. And since this was a space to entertain guests, it was naturally designed to impress. This first work that we're going to talk about here is impressive indeed. It would definitely reveal the worldliness of its owner. Bill, can you share a bit about this mirror and about Chinese exports in general?
I'd be glad to. So, Amanda, you mentioned something that was very important. People would have a meal, and then they would separate. And typically, the men would go to the library and have their cigars and sit around, and the women would go to the drawing room. And certainly if a woman came to visit, if I lived in one of these great homes and a woman came to visit my wife in the middle of the day, that's where they would go to tea, is the drawing room. So it was a feminine room but wanted to show off just like everything else, sometimes even more because obviously the women often were the ones that were designing and decorating the houses. So this is a Qing Dynasty export mirror painting. And what does that mean? Qing Dynasty obviously was the dynasty in China in the late 18th century, and this dates, the mid to late 18th century. So this dates about 1750, 1760. But what is an export mirror? An export mirror painting. We can go to the next picture. Okay, and this will help maybe show what it is. So let's see if I can explain this. Every painting that you have ever seen, the way it was done, if you go to a museum and see a painting, they paint the background and then they paint the foreground. And that's the way all paintings are done. You paint the background, then you paint the foreground on top of that. The problem with something, the great news about doing it that way is that if you mess up on the foreground when you're painting it. You just paint it back into the background and start over. This was done on a piece of glass. And so it was done backwards. You had to paint the back, you had to paint the foreground first, then the background. So there could be absolutely no mistake. And it took an extraordinary level of talent. And this is something that the Chinese did better than anybody else. They not only did it on this, but they also did it on snuff bottles, where they would take a little piece of hair and paint something inside the hole of the snuff bottle to do this. But why would a lady have something like this in their drawing room? They would have had it to show that they were worldly. They understood. Now, almost certainly they had never been to China. And almost certainly they had never actually even seen a Chinese person in their life. But this is what they envisioned, you know, and look at, you know, and not only that, but, you know, it's a picture of women. It's a picture of women and children and with the greatest detail, obviously in a palace. You know, and you know, with the fruit and playing games and the weather, you know, that the pond in the background and this fanciful look painted in China, but for the West, and you can see its scale, and it's called a mirror because, you know, it obviously was a piece of glass, but it's not something you can see yourself in. And it's just this really extraordinary piece that that dates, it's 270 years old and it's still in perfect condition, because if this ever fell, it's gone, and it's not something that can be repaired. And it's just, I love it because it's different, it's beautiful, it's fun, and it would have showed exactly how worldly the owner of it was.
I love this one too. The amount of detail in there is just really incredible. It's a beautiful piece. All right, so in keeping with our exotic theme, we have a great teapot from the ceramics firm Wedgwood. Bill, can you tell us a little bit about Wedgwood and also about the history of Egyptomania?
Well, certainly. Wedgwood was himself, he could be a subject of a whole bourbon with Bill without a problem. Suffice it to say, he was a genius. He was one of those very, very, very rare artisans that could think out of both sides of his mind. And his accomplishments in his lifetime were astounding. Egyptomania, it's somewhat hard to understand that from, you know, maybe early 1800, the late, you know, 1799, Napoleon goes to Egypt, and then this Egyptian mania takes over. And it really takes over in England about 1810. This is the first time things are coming to England, and great estates are bringing things in, and the British Museum is bringing things in. The Rosetta Stone actually arrives in England around this time, although it's not even deciphered until, I think, in 1823. And this incredible, people are just obsessed with Egypt. Here's this society that existed 20 centuries, 25, 30 centuries before that. That's incredible. An incredible amount of time. And so here's a teapot made, it's called Rosso Antico, with hieroglyphics on it. Now, they certainly didn't know what they were saying, you know, in these hieroglyphics, because there hadn't been a person alive in 20 centuries that could have read this. And it wasn't until about 15 years later that somebody could have actually deciphered what hieroglyphics meant. So obviously, but all done with a Nile crocodile on it. During the 19th century, when this was made, there were crocodiles in the Nile. By the 20th century, they were pretty much all gone. And Egyptomania lasted for about 110 years. It really lasted from about 1810 to 1920. And it was 1922 or 1923 when Howard Carter found the tomb of King Tutankhamun, and that was pretty much the end of it. And I remember reading something that said you couldn't go to a hotel anywhere in the world that didn't have some Egyptian motif in it the year after Howard Carter found Tutankhamun's tomb. But this was the very first of it. But having this on a lady having this in the drawing room and being able to pour tea from would have showed how worldly she was and how great it was. And it was just a great object that's, to me, still as timeless as it was when it was made.
Thank you. So we often associate the British with tea. However, a few of them did drink coffee as well, though the beverage was quite a bit rarer in stately homes. However, this coffee pot from Hester Bateman would have been right at home in a British estate. Bill, can you tell us about this pot and its maker?
Well, certainly. So this dates exactly 1782, and that's important. Prior to maybe 1750, 1740, a coffee pot just didn't exist in England. The reason why, tea was the drink of the wealthy, and coffee was the drink of the poor. And so, and a poor could never afford a coffee pot, and so there were basically none around. But coffee was drank on the continent. So somebody who would have had something like this would have almost certainly had been to the continent and developed a taste for coffee, because there was no reason for them to order it otherwise. But so whereas if you were looking at in 1780s, how many coffee pots, so great silver coffee pots and how many great silver tea pots were made, I'm gonna guess that ratio was about 500 or 1,000 to 1. For every one great coffee pot, there may have been 1,000 great teapots made in the 1780s and 1790s. So this is something that would have been quite rare, and it was made by the great Hester Bateman. Now, we discussed her a little bit on the Argyle pot. And you can maybe see it a little bit more here, how feminine it is. You can look at a piece of Hester Bateman, and let's just say there was a coffee pot by virtually every other maker in 1780s, you would look at it and you would say, one of them's made by a man, one's made by a woman, because the other one would have been much more masculine, much more heavy. She was able to make it graceful. Look at the spout with the little birds or dragon's head on the spout. You know, it has little beading on it. It's just so elegant. And, you know, I love the fact that this would have been made for a great home. And somebody, I am worldly. I have coffee, because it was almost like a sin drink for a while, because who drinks coffee? That's what poor people drink. A little bit of a side note. You can leave that up there, but a side note. When we give a tip to somebody, that comes from a British coffee house, and in the 18th century, in the beginning of the 19th century, coffee houses, they would serve coffee, and the waitresses made money were from tips. And what tips was, they would put a jar in the center and they would write something to ensure promptness. In other words, to make sure that you got your coffee if you asked for it, you put a little bit of extra money in that. And to ensure promptness, obviously the first letters for all those three are TIP, and that's where the term tip comes from. So this is interesting. These are the marks on the Hester Bateman, and they're important. Now, we've all heard the term that, you know, like British pound or British sterling, and they're synonymous. It's the same thing. Sterling was money, and sterling silver is 92.5% pure silver. Coins were 92.5% pure silver. And because of that, and silver was very, very, very expensive. So you wanted to make sure that every piece was exactly what it was supposed to be. So let me explain these marks if you can see them. The first one on the left is HB. That stands for Hester Bateman. We know she made it. The next one is what's known as the line passant. That means that it's sterling silver. It was assayed. It was tested by the assay office that it was sterling. The next mark is the leopard's head. That means it was tested in London. There were a number of assay offices. London was by far the biggest. And then the final is G. That's a mark for 1782. Why did they have all this? They didn't do that so they could help Bill Rao distinguish which pieces of silver were 239 years later. They did that because silver was so expensive. If somebody made silver instead of 92.5% pure, let's say they made it at 88% pure, they could make a fortune, because that 4% little shavings of adding a few more alloys, they could have made a fortune because that's how expensive silver was. So they needed to know. They needed to know who tested it. So how did they know who tested it? Somebody was in charge of the London Assay Office in 1782. And they did that so they knew if something ever was tested, if this coffee pot was tested in 1790 and it turned out not to be right, they knew who to go back and arrest. So they knew who was in charge of the assay office, and they wanted to know who made it also to make sure that Hester Bateman wasn't in cahoots with the maker. So That's why you had the maker and the person who was in charge, well, the town in charge, and of course they knew who the person was, that it's sterling in the year that it was done. So that's why these marks were there, which greatly helped build the Bill Rouse of today distinguish.
And the Amanda Jones. Right, we do have two questions here about this pot. Both of them are asking, what is the handle made of?
I don't remember. These were made of either wood, horn, or ivory. This is not ivory. And Hester Bateman typically did not use ivory. You'll see that on Paul's store pieces sometimes. It was either wood or horn. I don't know on this one because I can't tell in the picture what it is, and I don't remember. Most of them were wood, and certainly with that type of curve into it, I would guess that it to be wood, but it could be wood or horn. And the reason why is sterling is a great conductor of temperature. And if it was a silver handle, it would get too hot to hold. And so that's why they made it out of other materials that would not, that could handle the heat, and it would not conduct the heat through the handle.
Okay, great, thank you. So while the English liked to display their worldliness, they also celebrated their achievements a bit closer to home. This clock pays homage to St. James Palace, which was a 16th century royal palace built by Henry VIII. Bill, can you tell us a little bit about this clock and skeleton clocks in general?
Well, I love skeleton clocks. So let me give you my so you know that in the beginning. What makes a skeleton clock great? This was made in 1880, 1885. And by that period, even a poor person could afford a clock. And because a poor person could afford a clockmaker had a choice of either making a whole bunch of cheap clocks or make something really great. And nothing was really greater than a skeleton clock. Why? It's not that hard to make a clock and hide all the ugly parts. It's very hard to make a clock and make it beautiful where you can see all the way through it. And then the best ones still retain their original domes, like this one. This still has its original glass dome. And, you know, if you could see this with the pendulum ticking. So if you look at the picture on the left, you can sort of see all the gears in the inside. Think about all those things. Every one of those gears are turning and moving, and they all work. They all work for this. They all work, you know, whether it's on the second or whether it's on the minute or whether it's on the half an hour or a 15 minute or an hour, they all move at a certain pace. But to make all that beautiful and to make it so you can see it and admire it as a workmanship was extraordinarily difficult. If you see the very back of that picture, you see a black, you can see like big circles, that's the hour chime. And they would have had a hammer that would have hit it and go bong, bong, and you know, and it would vibrate in there. Now, if you look at the right picture and you see the arrow, this is something you don't normally see. That's what's known as a fusée spring. What is a fusée spring? It was invented because to keep the clock running accurately. So if you see the barrel at the bottom where the spring is going, and I'm hoping that you can all see this, it's completely round. But if you look at where the arrow goes, it actually tapers down. Why does it do that? In the very beginning of clocks, they had two barrels. One would turn and one would capture the cord of the same diameter. Well, the problem with that was when it was full at the top, the clock would run slow. In the middle, it would run accurate, and at the very end, it would run fast because it was uneven. They figured out how to spiral that down so it kept the exact amount of pressure on the clock, so the clock ran at the correct time all the time. So it wasn't fast at one part of the day and slow at the other part. And this would have been an 8-day clock. And it's just, to me, it's beautiful. You can see next to the wine bottle for scale. And this could have, of course, gone in the drawing room, but it could have gone in the library. It could have gone in the dining room. It could have gone in the foyer. It was a clock of showing off, but it would have fit right home in a drawing room because it was feminine and elegant and beautiful all at once.
So we're going to be ending our tour of the Great British Estates with a bit more of a private space, the dressing room. This first item was highly important to both a lady and a gentleman's toilette, the necessaire de voyage. Bill, what would something like this have been used for?
Well, it would have been made for the person that liked to travel. so they could take every single thing with them and fit it into a box and close it up and lock it. I'd had a place for letters that had a secret drawers if you wanted to put your jewelry in there. The mirror at the back actually pops open so you could put it on the counter, but it would have also been used at home. We go to the next picture. And you can see, this is just some of the pieces that are the inside. There's more. And all the different size bottles that would have been used for different things. I love the just like looking at some of the pieces on the bottom, and hopefully you can see these, but like, you know, I'm gonna put my glasses on so I can see them. Just going from the left, first of all, you have tweezers. Then you would have had a pencil that you could write with. Then a knife that you, if you had to open your mail or whatever, and then scissors. Then another different type of pencil that would have been used. The second to last one from the right is a corkscrew, because of course, you know, if you have an emergency, you have to have a bottle of wine, you have it. And the last one, which I love, is to tighten your shoes, because they would have had these little knots in their shoes, and that's, they would have used that to tighten their shoes. And so even the chances were thrown up. Look at the quality of the wood. That's Coromandel wood. That was a wood that was extraordinarily valuable. Think of the satinwood cabinet, same thing. And beautiful. And then here it is with all the pieces in, and there's layers underneath it. And by the way, those drawers that you'll see in the final picture that open on the side and front, they open with secret buttons. So it was something that would have sat in the ladies' dressing room or man's and been able to take when they traveled also.
Great, thank you. So before the age of electricity, candlesticks were a necessity in nearly every room, including one's dressing room. Can you tell us a little bit about these candlesticks from Paul Delamory?
Well, certainly. So when I mentioned that Paul Storer was by far the most famous silversmith of the Regency period, and some would say the most famous silversmith of all time, Paul Delamory was by far the most famous silversmith of the Rococo period, and some would say the most famous silversmith of all time. So those two Pauls would certainly get into an argument on who was the greatest. These are just an extraordinary set of four candlesticks made by the great Paul Delamory. They would have been anywhere in a house, but they would have certainly been at home in a ladies' dressing room, for the simple room, they were so feminine. They were Rococo. Rococo is actually a bastardization of the French term of seashell. You know, if you think of a seashell that goes around, it's asymmetrical. Look at this, the workmanship, it's asymmetrical, it just flows. Paul Delamory was a Huguenot silversmith that first trained in France, then went to Holland, then came to England. And his pieces are in museums all over the world. And a set of four candlesticks like this are extraordinarily rare. They're stunningly beautiful. They were made in 1741, which is the very, very beginning of the Rococo period. And they would have been perfectly at home in a lady's dressing room. So she would have liked to put on her makeup and see if her clothes matched perfectly.
They would have been a really great fit on this next side table we're going to talk about. It's inset with a truly special hard stone that's known as Blue John. Bill, what can you tell us about this British stone?
So there's very few marbles or stones that were somewhat valuable and desirable from the day they were found. Blue John is one of them. It was found in one mine in the world in the Derbyshire area of England. And Blue John pieces that are this big are considered big, and pieces that were round, and they would be taken and made objects of it. And the great makers of the day, including Matthew Bolton and other great makers, would take small pieces and make objects. This is a huge piece. It's this big round, and it's filled with amethyst, and it's one of the most beautiful pieces of Blue John anybody will ever see. This came from a very important noble house in England. So what would happen was one of two things. Either somebody found this piece and went to the great firm of Gillows, who was the most important cabinet maker of the day, and said, make me a table. Or Gillows, which they would have gone to the mines and said, we're looking for the best pieces that are sell them to us. Because once they get them, they can make a table and then almost ask whatever they want for it. And we show a picture of the table. It's rosewood, which was the wood of the wealthy in 1840, and with the most beautiful top. And this would have been perfect. And it would have been great because a lady could have left her cup of tea or a glass of water or her little bit of bourbon if she was drinking. I doubt she was drinking bourbon. It would have been Scotch whiskey for certain, you know, and left it on there without hurting it because it's a stone. It wouldn't have stained it, unlike if it was a wood top. And it's just a beautiful and elegant piece of furniture and extraordinarily rare.
So finally, we're ending with a truly stately piece for a stately home, a spectacular Chippendale chest on chest. Bill, what about this chest, aside from its obvious beauty, makes it so important?
Well, Thomas Chippendale was arguably the greatest cabinet maker of all time. He's one of three famed craftsmen that never made a penny. And the reason why he the other two being Lewis Comfort Tiffany, who made the Tiffany lamps and windows, et cetera, and John Henry Belter, the great American Rococo cabinet maker, whose things are in museums all over, wonderful car furniture. And the reason why none of the three made money is because they were perfectionists. They wanted things too perfect. They were not willing to settle for something that was second best or 99%. They only wanted things that were great. This was likely made by Thomas Chippendale. We can't tell you for sure if it was, but the quality of it is amazing. If you look at the picture that on the left and look at the figuring of the wood of it, he used the finest Cuban mahogany. The detail of the carving, when you look at the carving above the handle on the picture on the right, is just deeper than, you know, the fretwork on the picture on the left. The ormolu on the handles, and this is the original handles and the original escutcheons that you put your keys in, are all original. It's one of those pieces of furniture that when you look at it, it's just so much better than everything else you'll see. It's not as good, it's not almost as good, it's the absolute best, and it's the things, top of things that Chippendale made. Piece like this is pictured in the book, The Gentleman, the Cabinet Maker, that Thomas Chippendale wrote. It's just the best of all. I think we have another picture. Another sign of Chippendale things, and he was not the only one to use this, but he was the main one. He would put a red wash on the bottom of his pieces. Why? Wood, people lived in homes without solid floors. We don't think of that. I mean, we have all concrete slabs in our house, and we don't expect bugs to be crawling up. They had spaces between their stones and the floor, and bugs could easily get up. And so what would happen was, the next thing that's important is, when we think of these people, whoever owned this had servants. And so if you had servants, they were mopping the house. And where our mops, I'm sure there's a term for the strings at the end of the mops that I can't think of, that are this big. With the mops in the 18th century, the strings were that big. They were, you know, if there were somebody's hair from the back of their head to the below their derriere, and they were long, and people would, and the servants would take it, and this whole matter of mop would. And it would curl around the legs of pieces and hit pieces and wet them. So if you had wet wood, it was an invitation for bugs to get there. So one of the things that Thomas Chippendale did is he put this red wash on the bottom to keep the bugs away. And so it was another sign of work that he did. We can go back to the original picture. The quality of it is just amazing. It's known as a chest on chest. The reason why is literally it is a chest on chest. It was made in multiple pieces, but so that the top chest lifts up from the bottom chest. And it's just, the quality of it is unsurpassed. And for this would have been made for a noble home that would have sat there and would have been a great source of pride for whoever had it in their dressing room.
Really an incredible piece. That concludes our tour of the Great British Estate. And now we're gonna take time for a few questions. I wanna remind everyone that you can ask a question of Bill just by clicking that Q&A button down at the bottom and typing away. Let's get started, shall we? Our first question is going back to Hester Bateman. Someone says that she sounds like a fascinating person. How uncommon was it for a woman to be a craftsman during this period? And then we had another attendee who wanted to point out Louisa Courtauld, another 18th century female silversmith. So we know there was at least one more, but Bill, how common or uncommon was that?
I can't necessarily answer how uncommon a female craftsman was, although it was certainly extraordinarily uncommon. a successful female craftsman, there was just a handful. This was a patriarchal society. This was a society, Amanda, if you were wealthy and married somebody and they divorced you, they kept your money. Virtually every rule was made to suppress women in business. And for a woman to be able to have her own mark, I'm sure there were female craftsmen that were the main stars and, you know, use other people's marks, use their husband's marks, use their boss's marks, and they were the main stars and they were unsung heroes. But for a female to become famous and use her and be able to do her own mark and become successful and make things in a feminine touch, you can go into a table with 100 pieces and pick out the Hester Bateman piece almost from a distance, because it just, it's feminine. It has lines to it that the other ones don't have. So it was extraordinarily rare for a female to be successful in the 18th century and noted for it.
Great, thank you. So let's go back to that Chippendale chest on chest. Can you explain how exactly the red wash kept the bugs away and protected the piece?
The answer is no. I know there were chemicals in it that would have kept the type of bugs that would eat wood away. And so that's why I used it with the chemicals were, and it wasn't because it was red, because it was irrelevant. Nobody looked at the bottom of the chest of drawers, but it was just one of those added extra touches that Chippendale did that cost money, but he did it because he did not cut corners.
Another question about that. Did Chippendale ever sign his furniture? Apart from the red wash, how can you tell if a piece was by him?
So Chippendale never signed his furniture. And the way we know Chippendale pieces for sure, is that there are a number of pieces still in the great homes of England that still have the original bill of sale. So we have a chest of drawer that was by Thomas Chippendale with its original bill of sale. And we know for sure. He also wrote a book called The Gentleman, the Cabinet Maker. And in that book, he did his drawings. Now, the problem with that one is other people copied his drawings. And so when you look at a piece, you would say, how many of the attributes of a true Chippendale piece, known Chippendale pieces, are there, can we say? This one has a lot of them. It doesn't have all of them. That's why we're saying it's probably by Chippendale, but we're not saying it's definitely by Chippendale, because it doesn't have every single attribute that we would love to find on a piece. It probably was, the quality is so great, but it wasn't definitely. And so, but there were just all these different tick points that you'd want to check off as many of them as possible, but that's how you tell.
Great, thanks. So back to the Paul de Lamoury candlesticks, that great set of four. Someone is asking, are the bases of those solid?
They are. They're solid, but they're solid without, when we think of a lot of us, you know, silver that our parents had that, you know, bought in the 1940s or 50s or whatever, our grandparents have, you know, it had a flat bottom. These do not have a flat bottom. They're solid. They're not hollow at all. They're thick. But if you look underneath it, it'll be curved a little bit. It'll be curved a little bit underneath it where the curving is on those.
Okay, great. So another great question, how are you able to find and acquire these outstanding pieces?
I don't sleep much. the one advantage of us being in business 109 years is that a lot of these pieces we've owned before, these candlesticks we've owned before, we've owned them before, and because we've owned them before, we've been fortunate enough that they come back to us. That's not always the case. We sold a very, very important painting today, and I made the gentleman promise that if he ever sells it, that we'll get first pick to buy it back. Didn't put in writing, just a gentleman's agreement. Part of it is we look greatly for these great pieces, but because also we have so many great pieces, people know to call us when they have it. And so sometimes these pieces find us.
Great. And then this last question, I think, is a really great one to end on. Do you have a favorite British estate?
Do I have a favorite? Yes. Winston Churchill once quipped that he made his first great decision at a very young age when he decided to be born in Blenheim Palace. Blenheim Palace was a palace that was given to the Duke of Marlborough. And it's just extraordinary. I've been in a number of great estates, and this one sort of blows, you know, a lot of, you know, not including Buckingham Palace, which I don't consider an estate. It sort of just blows other things away. And so if I got invited to sort of like inherit something, I would like to inherit that with a nice budget to keep it up, because it wouldn't be cheap to keep up.
I don't think anyone would turn that one down, that's for sure. All right, well, thank you so much, Bill. We have had a few people ask throughout if this recording is going to be available somewhere else after we finish tonight. The answer is yes, we are going to be posting it on YouTube, hopefully by tomorrow, but just keep an eye on our website and that link will show up there. You can watch this all over again. Thank you, Bill, so much for being here and answering all these questions, telling us all of these great stories. We greatly appreciate you and all your knowledge. And thank you to everyone who joined us tonight. We appreciate you as well.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Take care, everyone. Goodbye.